We're going to continue our discussion of feature engineering by looking at some examples. The first example that I want to talk about is looking at a data set of trivia questions. And these are trivia questions from a game called Quiz Bowl that I use in my research. So before we get into that a little bit more deeply, let me talk a little bit about what the game of Quiz Bowl is. Quiz Bowl is a trivia game, but unlike other trivia games, the question is read a word at a time. And once you know the answer to the question, you can interrupt the question to give your answer. And the nice thing about this is that the questions are written in a way so that the questions begin with obscure information and get easier and easier as you go along, so the person who answers it first is more knowledgeable about the topic. So it's hard to explain, so let's show an example of this, and you can get an idea of what's going on. With Leo Szilard, he invented a doubly eponymous refrigerator with no moving parts. He did not take interaction with neighbors into account when formulating his theory of heat capacity, so Debye adjusted the theory for low temperatures. His summation convention automatically sums repeated indices and tensor products. His name is attached to the A and B coefficients for spontaneous and stimulated emission, the subject of his multiple groundbreaking 1905 papers. He further developed a model of statistics sent to him by Bose to describe particles with integer spin. For 10 points, name this German physicist best known for formulating the special and general theories of relativity. So hopefully, by the end of the question, you can recognize that the answer is Albert Einstein. The question is structured so that the hard stuff is at the beginning, and as you go deeper and deeper into the question, it gets easier and easier as you go. So, once you get to the end, you're talking about special and general theories of relativity, which is what everybody should know about Einstein. One thing that I often have to talk about is how this is not Jeopardy. And so in Jeopardy, people can only buzz at the end of the question. The reason that I use Quiz Bowl in my research is that Quiz Bowl is the better, in my opinion, trivia game because it does a better job of distinguishing who knows more about a topic. And so when Watson took on two very smart humans at Jeopardy, they had to play by the rules of Jeopardy. And in Jeopardy, you can only answer the question at the very, very end. And if you answer before that, you get locked out. And this is very problematic for the two humans who are not electromechanical buzzing machines. So essentially, Watson got to buzz on whatever it wanted to, and everything else was split between the two humans. So it wasn't a very fair competition, in my opinion. So one thing that I do in my research program is I work with these data and I try to build systems that can answer these questions. And one way of dividing up the task is you have a system that generates a bunch of guesses. We call this the guesser. And then you have a system that tries to determine whether the guesser got it right or not. And you can treat that as a classification problem. And because it's a classification problem, we can build features for it. And so let me talk a little bit about how you might do feature engineering for this problem. So what we're going to do is we're going to take a bunch of guesses, and for each one, we're going to try to decide, is this correct or not? And we'll iteratively build features that try to help us do this task better or not. And so this has been a feature engineering homework in my classes before, as well as determining the category of a question. So these are the kinds of things that I give as feature engineering homeworks. So the data set that I started the students off with had the clues that have been given so far, the text. You have the page, and so this is the Wikipedia page. So all of these questions have a Wikipedia page as the answer, and this is what the guesser has provided as a guess. You also have the actual answer, because this is training data. We know what the actual answer is, so we know what should be the answer to this question. You also get the body score. So the way that we're generating guesses is we're going to essentially type in the text of the question into the Wikipedia search bar, and that calls something called an information retrieval index that then returns a bunch of answers, and then that has a score associated with each of the guesses. And we're going to use that score of the guess as another feature, and it's a quite good feature. But hopefully we can do better and craft features that do better than the score. Okay, so first, let's start off with a baseline. What if we say that every guess is wrong? And so, most guesses are going to be wrong, but if we guess that every guess is wrong, we get a baseline of about 0.54. So everything that we should do should give us something better than 0.54. So one thing that we can do is we can take advantage that our answers and our guesses both come from Wikipedia. And since they come from Wikipedia, when you have an ambiguous answer, you have the name of the page followed by parentheses. So, for example, when you talk about Paris, you can talk about the mythological figure, you can talk about the city, there is a bird called Paris, and you also have a band called Paris. So all of these are possible things that can be referred to by the word Paris. So oftentimes, when you have a question about Paris, parentheses city, you'll have some text in the question that says something like, name this city home to the Eiffel Tower, the capital of France. And the string city appears somewhere within the question. And so we can create a feature that just asks, if we have parentheses, and look at the thing within the parentheses, does that appear in the question? We say true if it does, false if it doesn't. If we add that as a feature, we get a slightly higher performance of 0.58. So another thing that we can do is we can take a look at how many times you have a link to a Wikipedia page. And the number of links to a Wikipedia page shows how popular it is. And oftentimes, popular Wikipedia pages are wrong, as you can see in this plot. In red, you have the wrong answers, and those have a greater number of links than the right answers. If a page is popular, that often means that it's the wrong answer, which you can see from this graph. And so in red, you have the wrong answers, and those have more links than the right answers in green. And the right answers have a lower number of links. So let's include this as a feature. If we just add a feature, how many links does the guest have? Our accuracy improves just a little bit. But one thing that often happens is that the absolute number matters less and less. And so there's this very long tail of the number of links that you have. And if you take the log of the number of links, you get a much better feature because you have less of this long tail. And so once you take the log of the links, you get these nice distributions that we have here. So notice that we have a log scale down here. And you get things that look more like a normal distribution. And when you have a feature that looks more like a normal distribution, they typically work better as features. And so if we add that as a feature, we get a much higher improvement. So one thing that I said really early on is a very useful feature is just the score of the information retrieval system. And this is a really useful feature, and you would be crazy not to use this as a feature. And so by itself, it can get you over a 70% accuracy. So you should definitely use this. Maybe you could even do more with it by combining it with specific features. Another property of the dataset is that if you have longer questions, if you've seen more of a question, you're more likely to have good information in there. And so the number of words that you've observed as a clue is a really useful feature that you could be using. But by itself, it doesn't help very much. You only get a very slight improvement over your baseline. But when you combine it with the score that we talked about just before, multiplying them together, you get a huge boost in accuracy, getting over to 80% accurate. So when I use this as a homework, people did a lot of creative things like what tournament the question appeared in, who wrote the question. You can also think of a lot of very interesting things that you could use as your own feature on this kind of data. The bottom line for this and any other feature engineering exercise is to be creative, to understand your data, and try to create features that capture what's going on in your data so that your classifier can do a better job of processing the data and create good answers and good results.